1950s when rock and roll took the country by storm and a young man named Elvis Presley shocked the nation. In the 1960s, it was the Woodstock Nation. Now, in the late 1970s, a new and powerful music-based energy is making a massive cultural breakthrough. The punk cult. This is a 60-minute look at some of the most important music, people, and events that have helped define the phenomenon that is punk rock today, including comments and views from some of the most prominent journalists and critics on the music scene today. Plus, you will see live performance coverage of Blonde, bombshell Debbie Harry of the hit band Blondie. 18 months before these tapes were shot, this group played a punk club on the Bowery for as little as $25 per night. Admissions alone to their standing room only appearance for four nights less than 1.5 years later, the same time as these tape sequences were shot, grossed them over $8,000. That same week, still a virtually unknown group, their recording rights were purchased for over $500,000 cash. Their manager says they've just begun. These are the controversial Dead Boys. You'll see them do Sonic Reducer, All This and More, and Ain't Nothing to Do. You'll see them on and off the stage. Meet the record producer who helped them get it all down. Originally from Cleveland, Ohio, they became fast favorites of many on the scene. They've had a strong influence on bands from New York to Canada. Their album is called Young, Loud, and Snotty, and their stage act is one of the most provocative and powerful of any punk band anywhere in the world today. The Dead Boys are not pretty. They don't try to be pretty. They've been called brilliant. They've been called disgusting. But nobody ever forgets this act once they've seen it. And featuring the amazing Johnny, Joey, Dee Dee, and Tommy Ramone, the Ramones, formed in the summer of 74 and already on their third album, Rocket to Russia. This is the band that many have called the premier punk rock band in the world today. Their hit single, Sheena, was the first punk single to make the charts, and since that time, virtually all of their releases have been chart-bound. You'll hear Ramones talk and meet their influential manager, Danny Fields. All this and more coming up in the next 60 minutes. Elvis may have been the first punk, or James Dean. There were certainly punks before the word became fashionable, and there will certainly be punks after the word dies away. Differences between the musical groups coming out of this phenomenon called punk rock are probably as strong as their similarities. But there is no doubt about it. The world is witnessing an explosion of creative energy that started on New York's Skid Row.
Well, in New York, it started with the Ramones, I believe, back in... First time I saw it was in the summer of 1975, just out, after I got out of journalism school, and they blew me away. It was like nothing I'd heard in live in many years. the problem with everything you heard on the radio was either disco or this stuff that comes out of L.A., the kind of Linda Ronstadt, Eagles. Soft rock access that after a while just got to be boring, and Ramones went out there and just and played all these just strictly power chords, and their lyrics were wonderfully funny, and I stayed around for two sets until about 3 a.m. with this girl who didn't want to stick around for any of it at all, but she was afraid to go home alone, so I stayed for the whole thing.
The four-man band from Forest Hills, New York, called the Ramones, was formed in the summer of 1974, long before there were any English punk bands like the Sex Pistols or a punk scene in Los Angeles, Boston, or Canada. It is generally acknowledged that it was the Ramones tour of 1975 that played a big role in establishing punk footholds or scenes both in England and in this country where they played. In New York, the punk scene got off the ground at a then unknown club on the Lower East Side called CBGB's. Located in the heart of Skid Row at 315 Bowery, the raw and unrestricted environment was perfect for the new bands to try new things. CBGB's was not founded as a rock and roll club, but its owner, Hilly Kristal, had the foresight to recognize a good thing when he saw it and encouraged the bands to make it their scene. In the early days, there were not many bands. There were also very few people in the audience.
So we found CBGB's, like, it was just a bum bar on the Bowery, and nobody was playing, but, like, we saw that it could become a scene. Like, we wanted to develop it, make it something, you know. So we started playing for Hilly and the Dog, and eventually got up to like 700 people a night, you know.
The audience at that time, there wasn't much of an audience. It was in the Bowery, and nobody wanted to go down to the Bowery. Some derelicts and some brave people sometimes came down, and they liked us. We were different. And then the artists and weirdos started coming down, and they liked us.
Another group that formed almost at the same time as the Ramones was Blondie. CBGB's, however, was not the professional debut for lead singer Debbie Harry.
My real debut as a performer was in a play in, I think I was in about fifth grade or fourth grade or something like that. And it was a play called Cinderella's Wedding, and I was the soloist. And I sang I Love You Truly at Cinderella's Wedding.
I saw you standing on the corner. You look so big and fine. I really wanted to go out with you. So when you smiled, I laid my heart on the line.